Yeah, now I started. Okay, so so we'll look at thermoelectric effects first, and then we will move on to thermal transport. And you will see the formalism is very similar. Okay, basically the formalism is as follows. What we have to do is we have to find out the new distribution function. Okay, and given a new distribution function in the presence of an electric field and temperature gradient. Okay, if you have a new distribution function in the presence of electric field and gradient, then second thing is we have to calculate the observables. And what are the observables that we want to calculate? One is an electrical current. Okay, so this is an electrical current, which basically means charge transport. And second thing is the heat current. Okay, and you will see there is a very close relation between these two. And then finally, we will try to generalize this, the entire formalism, and see what comes out. Okay, in linear response theory, what comes out. All right, so J electrical was something that we had already calculated. Okay, so I will just go over those steps very quickly, and then we will write down full expressions for the Seebeck coefficient and for the electrical conductivity, the tensorial expressions. All right, so let's go ahead and do that. So basically, we'll start from the Boltzmann transport equation. And the Boltzmann transport equation just tells us that this, you must remember, the total derivative of the distribution function is basically equal to the collision integral. Okay, so this is the essence of the Boltzmann transport equation, right? And if you just remember this, you will be able to do the rest of the things. Okay, remember f is a function of r, k, and time. Okay, so which means a total derivative would involve an explicit derivative of time, a derivative of k, and a gradient of f, a derivative of r, and a gradient of f. Okay, so basically then what we will get is del f by del t plus vk dot gradient of f with respect to space, this is a spatial gradient, plus 1 by h cross. The del k by del t translates to f external dot gradient with respect to k of f, which is equal to the collision integral. Okay, now if you remember, the collision integral can be done at many levels. Okay, the simplest approximation is the relaxation time approximation. Sorry. And in the relaxation time approximation, you can go ahead and apply, for example, the Fermi-Golden rule. You can do full perturbation theory. You can do it many different levels. Okay, but the relaxation time approximation is the simplest level, in which the I collision of f is replaced by minus of f minus f0 by tau. Okay, so this is the simplest level approximation for this, and we can write this also as minus delta f by tau. Okay, where delta f is the change in the distribution function due to the perturbation, let's say external perturbation, or there is a gradient, and so on. Okay, the next thing we will do is to look at the steady state. So we are not currently looking at transients, right? So when you had turned on the electric field, for example, or when you turned on the thermal gradient, then initially there would be some changes in the system, right? And the distribution function would be an explicit function of time during the transient. But we are not looking at that. We are looking at the long time limit when the thermal gradient has been established, the electric field has also been established. So it's purely the steady state. Okay, so in the steady state, we expect that the explicit time dependence will go away. Okay, and the only thing that will remain are these two terms, the spatial gradient and the electric field, okay, the external field. All right, so if we have only an electric field which is not zero and a gradient in temperature which is not zero, then we can go ahead and write this as delta f by tau k is equal to E times electric field dot gradient of F minus Vk dot gradient with respect to space of temperature del F by del T. Okay. So all I have done is to invert this equation, write the right hand side on the left hand side. That's all. Okay. So this implies that the change in the distribution function is basically tau of k multiplying this quantity. So you can see now that there are two reasons for the change in the distribution function. One reason is electric field, and the other reason is the thermal gradient. Okay. So you can see this has two origins. One is this and one is this, right? So the electric field can cause a change in the distribution function, and the gradient in temperature can also cause a change in the distribution function, which is simple to understand, right? So if you apply an electric field, particles will move here and there, right? If the particles move here and there, the distribution function changes. The momentum distribution and the spatial distribution changes. Similarly, the thermal gradient will also do exactly the same. Okay. Now, what is important here is that, Shovik had also asked this yesterday, that will the relaxation time for both the electrical transport and the thermal transport be the same? Okay. So in this case, it turns out that the formalism does not allow you to incorporate a different relaxation time for the thermal gradient and for the electric field gradient, the potential gradient. Okay. In this case, the relaxation time is one single relaxation time, right? So, but ad hoc, if you want to extend this formalism, then you can multiply the tau to both E and to grad T, and then make the tau as tau 1 and tau 2. Okay. But if you follow this formalism faithfully, then there is no, you cannot make the tau different for the electric field and for the gradient in temperature. So that is not allowed. Okay. So given this, this is the change in the distribution function. And given the change in the distribution function, we can go ahead and calculate the observable. So that was the second step. Calculate the observable, which is the current. And the current is given by minus E by 8 pi cube. By the way, because there is a 8 pi cube here, the spin has not been included. But if you include the spin, this can become 4. Okay. And later on, you will see that I will use 4 here. Okay. Because that is from a different reference. And there the spin has been included. Okay. So V of K, F of K. So notice here that J is a vector. Okay. And this is the volume element in the first Brillouin zone. And then this V of K is also a vector. Okay. So if I want to get the X component of the current, then I should take the X component of the velocity. Right. And here you see this is the full distribution function. Okay. But what I can do is I can write this equally well in the following way. I'll show you one more expression, which is very convenient. Vk times delta F of K. So what I have done is I can do an F minus F0 in this integral and add a plus F0. Okay. And what I had shown you earlier was that if I just do this integral over F0 of K, then this integral is actually zero. Okay. Why is that? Because remember, F0 is an even function of V. And the Vx, Vy, Vz are appearing as an odd term here. So this integral becomes zero. Okay. So which means that instead of F here, I can actually replace directly the delta F. Okay. And why is this convenient? It's convenient because in the relaxation time approximation, we actually get delta F on the right hand side. Okay. So this delta F, you can see, is actually in terms of the F itself, the new F, right? And in the linear response approximation, this F on the right hand side is replaced by F0. Okay, so that was the other thing that we had done, which means on the right hand side now everything is known. Okay, it's purely in terms of F0, and it's in terms of the V of K, which is basically the gradient of the dispersion. So that is also known. Since everything is known here, we know what the current is, and this is the electrical current. Okay, so this is electrical current. Or the charge current. This is not heat current. Okay. So this is very important to remember. This is all electrical current because we are looking at the velocity, multiplying that with the charge, which is minus E, right? And then writing down the full expression for the current, okay? So this is, and in this delta F, now we are going to substitute this expression, okay? So this expression is going to be substituted here with F being replaced by F0, okay? Any question?
Sir, can you please explain this? I forgot the argument which we gave yesterday. Like for the inclusion of the temperature, we are including velocity, then grade of T, and then df by dt.
Huh. So you're talking about this expression, Vk dot grad f, grad r of f?
No, that I understood. We are getting from the derivative of that part. Where again a df by dt is there?
Because see the gradient of the distribution function, okay, the spatial gradient basically has a gradient of the temperature. See, remember the distribution function depends on temperature, right?
Yeah.
Huh? So I'm saying that if you take this Vk dot grad Rf, then this is basically Vk, okay, dot. Now here you can do a, remember the R here, F does not depend on R directly, okay? F depends on temperature. Temperature in turn depends on R, right? So what you can do is you can split this up as del F by del T times grad R of F. This is of T. So this is what we have done. Is this your question?
Okay. Means here if I have some beta terms there, so we are using that.
Yes, that's correct. No, because see, remember F is a distribution function and it was the Fermi-Dirac distribution function in equilibrium. Okay. Right?
Yeah.
Now out of equilibrium in the steady state, we are assuming, we are not assuming global equilibrium, but we are assuming local equilibrium. Okay. So we are assuming that the system can be split up into parts which are not completely microscopic, but not in the thermodynamic limit, okay? But are large enough that we can assume local equilibrium in each part. That is the idea.
Okay. Yeah.
Did that answer your question? Yeah, completely.
Yeah,
okay, thank you. Fine. All right, so now what we'll do is we'll take this change in the distribution function and then substitute that into the current expression, okay? And that will give us the current as a function of the electric field and also as a function of the spatial gradient, okay? And through that we will derive the Seebeck coefficient, which is a thermoelectric coefficient. Okay, so let's see how that is done, and you will see how the tensorial nature of the conductivity also drops out of this, right? So the J will be then written as minus E by 8 pi Q dK V of K times delta F of K. Okay. And in this delta F, now I want to substitute the expression that we had obtained using the Boltzmann transport equation. So this is actually a vector V of K. And this delta F of K here, I'm going to substitute, and here I will get a relaxation time, okay, multiplied by E times electric field by H cross dot gradient K of EK del F by del E minus VK dot gradient of T, this is with respect to space, of del F by del T. Okay. By the way, this Vk and this gradient of Ek by H cross, both are actually Vk. Okay. So there is, these are both Vks only. So I could have written that, and I'm going to write that in the next expression. So this can then be simplified as follows. Integral dk V of k tau of k. So the tau is a scalar, but the V is a vector. Okay. And this is E electric field dot Vk times del f by del e. Or let me write this slightly differently to show you the linear response relation. Okay, so I'll write this as del f by del e vk, and then there is a e here, times the dot the electric field, minus del f by del t vk dot gradient of the temperature. Okay. Right. So, okay, there is actually a puzzle here. Okay, it's not very straightforward. Let me tell you what is the puzzle. Okay. Suppose I have there is in some sense an inconsistency, not a puzzle really, it's an inconsistency, and we are actually glossing over it. Okay, it's an approximation. Let me tell you what that approximation is. Let's say I have a wire or a sample in which I maintain a thermal gradient T1 to T2, okay? And say the T1 is greater than T2, right? Now, which means that if I draw the graph of temperature versus the position, and let's say this is what I take as the origin, then I would get some profile of the temperature, okay? I could get something like this, okay? Or I could get something like this, or I could get something like a straight line, right? So a priori, do I know what is the temperature dependence on position? I don't. Okay. Do you all agree that I don't know to begin with? How does the system reach the steady state? Okay. It could either be a decaying profile, it could be a sort of saturating and then decaying profile, or it could be a completely straight line, and so on. Okay. So we don't know. Depending on what material we have chosen, it could be different. Also, there could be, for example, Joule heating effects, okay, and there could be all sorts of different kinds of phonon bottlenecks and so on, which can lead to a completely new temperature profile, right? So in the absence of this, remember the del f by del t is actually a function of temperature, right? What I mean is, even if I had taken, remember this is also the Fermi Dirac distribution function, because on the right hand side we have to replace this by f0, right? So if I take the f0, then there is a e to the power e minus mu by kbt plus 1. Okay, now when I'm calculating this current here, right, then you can see that there is actually a del f0 by del t, and there is also a gradient in temperature. So the gradient in temperature, first of all, will you be calculating this gradient at which position? Will you calculate this? Will you calculate this here? Because the gradient will be here. If you calculate it here, the gradient will be like this. It's only in the case of a straight line profile that the gradient will be the same throughout the sample. Okay, so assuming that the gradient is the same throughout the sample, then the other inconsistent thing is that what temperature will you use to calculate the del f0 by del t? Okay, because remember the f0 is actually a function of temperature. So when you calculate the derivative with respect to temperature, again the del f0 by del t will also have a temperature inside it, right? But the temperature is not the same throughout the sample, right? But the current is. So the current has to be the same throughout the sample, okay? So what temperature will you use in this, right? So this kind of an inconsistency, at least theoretically, is removed by saying that the thermal gradient that we are considering is very, very small. Okay, that basically what we are saying is the delta T, which is T1 minus T2, divided by the maximum of T1, T2, okay, maximum of T1, T2, should be much, much less than 1. Okay, so in this case, you can assume the average of T1 and T2 to be applicable to be you can substitute the average of T1 and T2 in the del F0 by del T, right? But you can see that it's going to be a huge approximation if T1 and T2 are widely different. And if you look at the literature where people try to make thermoelectric generators, which means that let's say you have a furnace, okay, and in this furnace there is you might be making cement, for example, or there is a coal plant, right? So there's a lot of heat that is getting generated, okay, and the temperature will be of the order of 1000 degrees Celsius, right? So you want to connect a thermoelectric material here, okay, and this is ambient condition, so maybe room temperature, right? So this is 300 Kelvin or 27 degrees Celsius, and using this thermoelectric generation, this would be, let's say, your T1, this would be T2, and you want to generate a current, okay, and that current you want to use it for some purposes, okay, some household purposes or some industrial purposes or whatever, right? So here in this condition you can see that the T1 and T2 are widely different, okay, and if T1 and T2 are widely different, then these expressions that we are deriving do not hold strictly, okay, and in fact when we look at the response coefficients, the response functions, these response functions will be strongly temperature dependent, right? But which temperature do you take when you take, for example, the thermal gradient, or which position do you take, and so on? These kind of questions are actually quite vague. Okay, they are not precisely answered within the Boltzmann transport formalism. In fact, there is also a much deeper question. Okay, the much deeper question is that what exactly is temperature if there is a thermal gradient, right? So what I mean is that here you might have a reservoir, okay? This is a reservoir with temperature T1. This is another reservoir with temperature T2. For a reservoir, temperatures are very well defined because they are thermodynamically large objects. But if your device here is a small object, it could be, for example, a nanotube, or it could be a wire or whatever, here the temperature is assumed to be changing as a function of position, right? But temperature by itself is defined as a thermodynamic quantity. It's defined only for a very large number of particles which are in equilibrium with a reservoir, right? So here, what is a reservoir, right? And the system is not really in equilibrium. It's actually in steady state and it's out of equilibrium. So there is an assumption of local equilibrium that is going in. And if the thermal gradient is extremely large and the system is extremely small, then this assumption of local equilibrium actually breaks down. Okay, so there are many inherent assumptions and approximations that have gone into this Boltzmann transport equation, but at the level of Boltzmann transport, which is a semi-classical equation, these assumptions and approximations have been sort of glossed over. Okay, so if you want to go to a more sophisticated level, then you have to abandon the concept of equilibrium completely. In fact, you have to abandon the concept of temperature itself inside the device, okay? And you can only say that there is a temperature on one side and there is a temperature on the other side, and inside the system there could be a heat current and a charge current, and you should be able to find that out irrespective of what is the temperature profile, okay? Because you can't even define a temperature profile, okay? And let me give you a realistic example. So it turns out that in computer chips, for example, which are, you know, inch by inch squared, there are certain hot spots that can develop, okay? And what people have been trying to do is that they have been trying to do forests of carbon nanotubes, right? So there are these forests of carbon nanotubes, they try to grow them, and through these forests they try to extract out the heat, right? And in the process, maybe, you know, using some thermoelectric materials, they should be able to generate some electricity also, because the top electrode could be, for example, water cooled. So there is a water cooled top electrode, and then here the chip itself, this is, for example, Intel Xeon. Okay, so the Intel Xeon is inside some computer, and it's running a large calculation. So because it's running a large calculation, it's getting very hot, And especially there could be some regions on the chip which are getting hotter than others, right? So this forest of carbon nanotubes is supposed to take out all that heat and also in the process convert the heat, because there is a thermal gradient, to electricity, right? And that should be again usable inside the system somewhere, let's say to charge the battery or something, right? But in this process, you can see that the heating or the thermal gradient is actually very, very large, right? Because this device is of the order of nanometers over which you want to transport the heat. Whereas the thermal gradient itself could be, this could be, for example, room temperature. And this could be of the order of even, 100 degrees Celsius. Some hotspots can actually reach that, 80 to 100 degrees Celsius, right? So then the thermal gradient is very large because it's of the order of nanometers. So all these approximations that we have made cannot be strictly applied for analyzing this kind of a problem, right? So is it clear that the approximations and assumptions that we are making, okay, are actually quite drastic, right? And one should not be making them if one wants to do a very, very precise analysis of a system where the thermal gradient is extremely large, right? So the concept of equilibrium itself breaks down, the concept of temperature breaks down, right? The thermal profile is not known. So there could be many different problems. So if it's not clear, let me know. Or if there are any questions, then let me know now. Is it clear?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, the transport equations that we wrote in the last page, are those equations for this DC electric field only? Or is it?
Yes, that's correct. This is only for DC electric field, because we have assumed here that there is nothing which is time dependent explicitly. If you had, let's say, an electromagnetic wave or something, then we would have to incorporate both the electric field and the magnetic field, which are explicitly time dependent.
Sir, in those cases, will dou f by dou t be zero?
Not necessarily. In fact, it will become a periodic function.
So are these AC and DC, that condition and the steady state condition dependent, like?
So the steady state will become a periodic condition then. So there is periodicity involved. So in the steady state, you will get a periodic response. And that periodic response is supposed to have exactly the same frequency, or at least, there would be harmonics of the incident frequency.
Okay.
So this situation is very different. What we are considering right now as a steady state is basically you have turned down a DC electric field and you have turned down a thermal gradient and you have waited for a very long time to see the response of the system.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So, so this is what I can now write as sigma times electric field. Okay. And then I am going to write here another thing, which is the following: sigma s. Sigma s times gradient of temperature. Let me see if I have written that. Okay, there is actually a minus sign here. Okay, so let me explain what I have written. This J is now dependent, as you can see, on electric field and also on the thermal gradient. And the coefficient of the electric field is actually a tensor, right? Why is that a tensor? Because suppose I consider the X component of J, right? Then it will be given by the X component of the V, right? But you can see here that there is a dot product of V and E, which means this will be expanded as Vx, Ex, Vy, Ey, and Vz, Ez, right? Which means that the X component of the current is dependent on all the three components of the electric field, right? So which is why if I find Jx, for example, then it will be something multiplied by Ex plus something multiplied by EY plus something multiplied by EZ. Okay, and that something will be called sigma XX plus sigma XY plus sigma XZ. Okay, and this way you can see that JX, JY, JZ will be dependent on sigma YX, sigma YY, sigma YZ, and so on, right? So all of that can be written in a compact form as a tensor. So like this, like a double arrow. And the coefficient of the gradient of temperature is actually called sigma S. Okay, this is the conductivity and S is the seebeck coefficient, or it's also known as the thermopower. Okay, seebeck coefficient. In some places you will see thermopower and the notation is Q. Okay, so in fact, this notation for the thermal transport, thermoelectrics, and so on, it's different authors use very different notations, right? And it can be very confusing also. What exactly is thermopower here, right? So it's not exactly power. As you can see, power is defined as the rate of work done. Here it's not that. Okay, here it's actually a response function. And the seebeck coefficient is also not defined independently. You will see how the seebeck coefficient is defined. It's actually defined through this product. Okay, so as we go along, you will see how to extract purely the thermopower or the seebeck coefficient from a different relation, right? So let's go ahead with this and write down by looking at this expression, by looking at this, okay, we will be able to extract both the sigma S and the sigma tensor. Okay, so let's write down the sigma tensor by looking at this. And if you see, the sigma tensor is basically given by this whole thing, okay, here. So which is minus E by 8 pi Q integral dk tau of k. And this becomes E squared tau of k. And then there is a del F 0 by del E V of k. V of k. Okay, and this V of k, writing this doesn't mean that we are taking a dot product. Okay, remember that this is a tensor, which means if you want to get, for example, sigma xy, you have to take Vx, Vy, right? So that's the meaning of this expression, right? So similarly, if I want to get the sigma s tensor, then that will be given by E by 8 pi Q integral dk V of k tau of k del F 0 by del T times Vk. Okay. And from this, I'm going to show you something nice, that is del F 0 by del T can actually be written again in terms of the del F 0 by del E. And that expression is, so the del F0 by del T turns out to be equal to minus of E minus mu by T times del F0 by del E. Okay, so if I substitute this expression here, right, then we will get sigma S tensor is basically E by 8 pi Q integral dk V of k tau of k, and then there will be a minus sign again. This will become E minus mu by T del F0 by del E times V of k. Okay, so now if you see the difference between the sigma and the sigma S, right, you will see that there is an extra factor of E minus mu by T, and in this expression there is an extra E, right? Otherwise these two expressions are very, very similar, right? So what I can do is, let me remove this part.
Hello, sir. Mu is chemical potential here.
Haan, mu is a chemical potential, yeah.
Okay.
That's correct. So if you are working at low enough temperatures, you can replace that by the Fermi energy. Okay. So what we can do is we can define an integral n, where that integral is basically given by dk tau of k vk. So this is also a tensor, right? And then we can define an e minus mu to the power n times del f0 by del e. Okay, so if we define a new integral in such a way where there is a e minus mu to the power n, then you can see that the sigma will be given by minus e squared by 8 pi cube times I0. Okay, and the sigma s is basically given by minus e by 8 pi cube t I1. Okay. And if you know this general expression for IN, then you know both the sigma and the sigma s, right? And from this, in fact, you can calculate the sigma coefficient or the sigma tensor by taking the inverse of this, right? And then multiplying it to this expression, right? Minus e by 8 pi cube t times I1. Okay. So this can be used to extract the S, the Seebeck coefficient. Okay. So this tells us that the J depends both on the electric field and the gradient in temperature. And even if you did not have an electric field, but purely a thermal gradient, that can give rise to an electrical current also, right? That's the basis of the Seebeck effect. That is, you have a thermal gradient and the thermal gradient produces an electric field, a current. But if you run the experiment, if you run the experiment under open boundary conditions, which means under open circuit conditions, which means J is zero, then you can see that you can actually produce an electric field, which can be measured as a voltage, right? So a thermal gradient will produce an electrical voltage, right? Which can be measured using a voltmeter under open circuit conditions. And that is also called the Seebeck effect. Okay, so is this point clear? That basically using the Boltzmann transport equation for charge transport, we are able to derive both the Ohm's law as well as the Seebeck effect. Okay, so both these effects have come out using the Boltzmann transport equation in linear response and in steady state. And on the right hand side, we know everything, right? Except this tau of k. This tau of k is not known because the tau of k depends on what kind of scattering processes you can take into account, right? And there are detailed models for calculating the relaxation time as a function of k, but then these detailed models you will have to take, for example, phonon, electron phonon scattering, electron defect scattering, and so on, and use the Matthiessen's rule and so on to combine these different relaxation times and get a single relaxation time. Okay. So until this point, are there any questions?
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, what does inverse of the inverse of sigma tensor in the Seebeck coefficient mean?
So it's a 3x3 matrix in three dimensions. So you can take the inverse of that and get the sigma S tensor.
In general, the inverse of tensor means?
It's a matrix representation. Is just a rank 2 tensor, so you can write it as a 3x3 matrix, and I mean each index is basically having three values, one x, y, z. That's why the inverse can be written here.
Okay.
As the inverse of a 3x3 matrix. That's all. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Any other question? Yeah. Sorry, Shovik, your voice is breaking. Hello. Shovik, I think your internet is not working today. Is that right? Okay, you can probably send me the question.
Hello.
Okay. So Shovik, let me know your question by email. I think your network is not good today.
Sir, am I audible now?
Now I can hear you. Yes.
Sir, in heat transport part, there was a E minus nu by into del F0 daily. And we know del F0 daily is
A delta. Shovik, one second. First of all, we are not looking at heat transport. In fact, that was the that's what I'm trying to emphasize.
Current due to temperature gradient.
Correct. See, this is the electrical current, right? Which is dependent on the electric field, right? And then there is a thermal gradient component, which is also contributing to the electrical current, right? So this is a thermoelectric part. Yeah, go on.
In sigma s tensor, there was a part epsilon minus u into del F0 del epsilon, and del F0 del epsilon is almost a delta function. Delta function only applies for E equals to nu. And if E equals to nu, then the total system will be zero. Then how can a temperature, if there is a very much temperature gradient, then how can it give rise to electrical current?
Very good. Very good question. So let me tell you the answer. So this is strictly a delta function, okay, only at T equal to zero. Okay. However, if you go to any finite temperature, then this is actually a resonance, right? And the width is of the order of 3 to 4 kBT, depending on how you measure it. You understand? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now the thing is, suppose you are working at temperatures of the order of 300 to 1000 Kelvin. See, remember, most of the thermoelectric generators try to extract the waste heat and then convert that to some useful current, for example. Okay, so people try to work with furnaces and other kinds of systems where the temperatures can be extremely large, right? So this is not at all zero temperature, first of all. Do you agree?
Yes, sir. That means here chemical potential is not strictly the Fermi energy. There is some difference, and the total integration is not zero, I think.
Exactly. So first of all, the mu is a function of temperature. That is one thing you rightly pointed out. Okay. The other thing is the del F0 by del E is also a function of temperature.
Has spread also. Has a spread of KBT or 4 KBT.
It has. Now the question is, when you calculate the electrical current, what temperature will you input into this? What temperature will you substitute? Do we have an unambiguous answer for that?
No, sir, you told that average.
Exactly, but that is not an unambiguous answer, isn't it? That is just an approximation.
What about the experimental input?
So experimentally also people do the same thing. In fact, there is a very good group in JNC, Kanishka Biswas's group, in their group, they do a lot of these thermoelectric experiments. Okay, and in fact, they have discovered some materials which are probably beating the industrial standards as well. Okay, so in their lab, I have spoken to them at length, and even though there is a thermal gradient, what they do in practice is that they find out the sigma S as a function of temperature. Okay, so which means that you apply some thermal gradient, right? And that thermal gradient could be, for example, what you do is you take 300 to 350, then you take 350 to 400, then you take 400 to 450, and so on. And for each of these, let's say this is T2 and this is T1, okay? So for this, you find the sigma S at 325, right? Then you find this at 375 and so on, okay? So basically then you will be able to get sigma S as a function of temperature, okay? So it will have some form, right? So you can see that this is not a very rigorously defined quantity, at least within Boltzmann transport formalism. Okay, and strictly speaking, one has to keep the temperature profile pretty smooth and also close to linear. Okay, if you want to define a gradient in temperature unambiguously. Otherwise, even the gradient in temperature is not uniform over the sample, right? So there are a lot of assumptions and approximations that have gone in. But certainly this is not a delta function. The del F by del E is not a delta function at all. We are working at pretty high temperatures in practice.
Yeah.
Okay. So now let's go into thermal transport, which means now we are going to look at the transport of heat itself, right? And there is a different reference that I'm using now, and this reference is actually available in the resources drive folder that I have sent you, okay? And it's let me show you what that is. I'll just point out, so it's called wait, where is that? Yeah. So it's called okay, it doesn't seem to be there here. I will be uploading this, okay? It's called Boltzmann Transport Theory, and I think this is not, yeah, this is not Russell House. Okay, I will upload this resource also, and you can go through this if you want more details for understanding the Boltzmann transport. But basically, let me tell you what the theory is. This is for thermal transport. And for thermal transport, again, we are going to look at the Boltzmann transport equation. Okay, so again, the two steps are, the first step is to find delta F, which is the change in the distribution function, right? And then the second step is to calculate the observable. Okay, so in the in whatever we did previous to this, we found the delta F in the presence of an electric field and in the presence of a gradient in temperature. Okay, in the case of thermal transport, it's exactly the same. We apply an electric field, we apply a thermal gradient, and then we want to calculate what is the transport, or what is the transport property of in terms of heat. Okay, so what is heat transport coefficients, right? So the change in the distribution function that we calculated for electrical transport will remain exactly the same for thermal transport as well. Okay, that is not going to change, but what is going to change is the observable. Okay, so this part is already done for us, right? We know what that expression is. All we have to do is we have to calculate the correct observable. Okay, and in the case of electrical current, we knew the observable. It's just given by the charge multiplied by the velocity multiplied by the distribution function, or the change in the distribution function, right? So this was just NEV, okay, that is the J. This is what we had to do for the electrical current. For the heat current, we have to do something different, okay? So the what we'll do is we'll use the first law of thermodynamics. Okay, now you can see already that we are doing something wrong in calculating the heat current. Can somebody tell me what is what is being, I mean, what am I doing wrong here? If I want to calculate the heat current, can I use the first law of thermodynamics? Any idea? So what I'm saying is, I'm calculating heat current. Okay? And in calculating,
I think it is applicable for equilibrium conditions.
Exactly. Very good. So thermodynamics is actually applicable only for equilibrium systems. And strictly speaking, I should not be using equilibrium theorems, equilibrium laws for calculating observables out of equilibrium. Absolutely correct. Okay. But in the spirit of Boltzmann transport equation, where we have mixed together classical phenomena, quantum mechanical phenomena, we have assumed local equilibrium and so on. So there is a huge mishmash going on here. Okay. And in the same spirit, we are going to use the first law of thermodynamics, which will give us an expression for the heat current. Okay. So basically the dQ is TdS. And remember, this equality is also valid only for reversible phenomena, right? So this is an equality that we are using for irreversible phenomena. There is a greater than or equal to, right? So we assume that this is equal to this dE minus mu dN, right? So if we divide it by the total volume, then we will get this dE minus mu dN, okay? Where dE is the energy density. So this is energy density. Okay, this is the number density, right? And this will basically give us the heat current, right? As JQ, which is the heat current, is basically T times JS. This is the entropy current, and that will be given by the energy current minus the number current. Okay. So this is E. So you can see that the heat current has two components. One is the energy current, right? And one is the number current. And what is the difference between these two? Can anybody point out? What is the difference between energy current and the number current?
Sir, conduction and convection.
Exactly. Very nice. So energy current is basically conduction, where the particles do not have to move. Right, there is an exchange of energy between particles, whereas the JN is a number current, where there is actually convection happening, which means there is a transport of material, right? And that is leading to a heat current also. So the heat current has two parts, conduction and convection, and both have to be taken into account in order to calculate the heat current. Okay, so given this, we can now calculate both of these currents separately. Okay. Now, Jn is something that we had already calculated. Okay. Now, Jn is actually given by exactly the same expression as this. Okay. And the Jn is basically integral dk times v of k, f of k, or delta f of k times 1 over 8 pi q. Okay, this is the number current. Now, what is the difference between the number current and the electrical current? It's just the minus E is not there, right? Minus E was the charge. Okay, and if you remove the charge, then basically what you get is a number current. Okay, and what is the energy current? For the energy current, we have to insert an energy also here. Okay, but it's not bare energy. It's the energy minus the chemical potential. It's the difference in the energy with respect to the chemical potential. That is what goes in here. And that we should write as, again, 1 over 8 pi q integral dk times E times V times delta F. Now in this, all right. Oh, okay. So it actually comes out in, so this is actually EK itself, but then when we combine these two, the EK minus mu comes out automatically. Okay. So if we now substitute these two into this, then you can see that we will get a 1 over 8 pi q integral dk times v times this. There is no vector here. This is not a vector. This is just the dispersion. Okay, this is just E of k, and this will become E k minus mu times delta f. Okay, so this is the heat current. Is this clear now? That this is the heat current. Is this expression clear? And you can see that this E minus mu, we had defined this integral IN, okay? And this IN integral was basically dk tau k v of k v of k times E minus mu to the power n, right? And remember, in delta f there is already one term which is proportional to the electric field where there is no ek minus mu, and another term which is proportional to the gradient in temperature where there is already one ek minus mu present. Okay, so this is going to give us again an I1 and an I2. Okay, I1 because the electric field term does not have a ek minus mu, so this will give one power of ek minus mu, and the gradient in temperature already has an ek minus mu, so that will give us a square. Okay, and then we will get a I2. So which means you can see that for various transport quantities, we basically have to calculate this particular integral. Okay, and if you can calculate this integral for all n in general, then you have all the different the currents, okay, or all the different response functions, right? And the form is very, very similar, right? The form is not different at all. Okay, so that is something that one has to remember. So again, substituting into this, what we can write in general is the following. Okay, it's L11 times electric field minus L12 times the gradient in temperature, and the JQ is basically L21 times the electric field minus L22 times the gradient in temperature. Okay, and what is L11? L11 is basically sigma. Okay, L12 is what we call the sigma s, right? And so on. So we'll come back to the JQ also, what they are called. Okay, so is this point clear, that when we substitute for the delta f, we will again get an electric field term and a gradient in temperature term? Is that point clear? And basically this will then turn out to be equal to 1 over 8 pi q times the I1 times the electric field plus I2 times the gradient in temperature. Okay, so that's what this will turn out to be. Is this point clear? Any doubts? So again, this is also telling us something interesting. This is telling us again that if you have an electric field but no thermal gradient, that can also produce a heat current. Okay, and if you apply a thermal gradient, of course you will produce a heat current, right? But one thing to remember here is that the heat current is actually produced by two entities in a normal solid. Okay, there are phonons and there are electrons as well. What we are doing here is purely for electrons. Okay, now can somebody tell me why is this equation only valid for electrons?
We have taken Fermi distribution function.
Very nice. Yeah, so the f here has been restricted to the Fermi Dirac distribution function, and we are looking at changes purely in the Fermi Dirac distribution function, right? So if you had written down similarly a phonon distribution function and the change in the phonon distribution function, then apply the Boltzmann transport equation for that as well, and then do exactly the same thing. Okay, but then do you think for phonons we would have got the electric field term?
No,
right?
No,
it's not possible to get that because the phonon doesn't have a charge.
Yes,
right. So for phonons we would not have got the electric field term, but certainly the gradient in temperature would remain. Okay, good. So with this, now we can write down the expressions as follows. So let me write again what I wrote on the previous slide. It's basically the electrical current is given by L11 times the electric field minus L12 times the gradient in temperature. Okay. And the J heat is L21 times the electric field minus L22 times gradient in temperature. Okay. And L21 and L12 are not the same, by the way. Okay. Because remember, the L12 had a 1 over temperature inside it, but the L21 does not have it. L21 is only written in such a way because there is a E minus mu that enters, and this one also has an E minus mu. So both of them are dependent on the I1 tensor. Okay. Whereas this is dependent on the I2 and this is dependent on the I0. All right. So, right. And if you want to be more precise, then it turns out that L11 of alpha beta. Okay. Remember, all of these are tensors, by the way. I should have written it like this. These are all tensors. Okay. And if I want to get the alpha beta component, then that is going to be equal to E squared by 8 pi cube times the I0. Okay. Tensor alpha beta. Right. Similarly, the L21 alpha beta is going to be equal to T times L12 alpha beta, and that's equal to minus E by 8 pi cube times I1 alpha beta. Okay. And then L22 alpha beta is 1 over T times I2 alpha beta. Okay. And just to remind you, IN is again integral dk tau of k. This is a tensor V of k. And then E minus mu to the power N del F0 by del E. So that's basically the IN. All right. So these coefficients define these equations. Okay. Now what we can do is we can recast these equations in the following way to connect with what happens in the literature. Okay. So, and I will tell you what these terms are, what these different terms are. We'll take the first equation. Okay. And write it as E equal to rho times J plus S times gradient of temperature. Okay. So what have I done here? The J is given by L11 times E minus L12 times grad T. Okay. And remember, this was basically the sigma tensor and this was the sigma S tensor. Right. Now this I can take it on the other side. Okay. And then the sigma tensor, I can multiply the entire thing by the sigma inverse. Okay. And sigma inverse is what I'm calling the resistivity. Okay. So this is the resistivity tensor. This is the current. This is a vector. This is the Seebeck coefficient tensor. And this is gradient in temperature. Okay. So I've just recast the first equation to write it like this. Okay. And the second equation, I'm going to write it exactly as it is, but I'm going to use a different symbol, pi times J minus kappa times gradient in temperature. These are all Greek symbols. So this is the thermal conductivity. Okay. So I'm coming to that now. So basically, what are the rho? The rho is given by L11 inverse. Okay. And the Q or the S tensor is given by L11 inverse times L12. Okay. And the pi here is given by L21 times L11 inverse. The order is very important. You can't exchange the order. And the kappa is given by L22 minus L21 times L11 inverse times L12. All right. And what are these different quantities? The rho is basically resistivity. And if the thermal gradient was zero, then basically E is equal to rho J. Okay, so that's how the resistivity is defined, right? And then Q or S is the thermopower or the Seebeck coefficient. Okay, and then there is this pi here, that's actually the Peltier coefficient. And you can see the Peltier coefficient is basically going to define a heat current is equal to pi times the electrical current when the thermal gradient is zero. Okay, so basically what this is telling us is that even if there is no thermal gradient and you apply an electric field such that there is a current flowing, that current, that electrical current can give rise to a heat current. Okay, and that is basically the Peltier effect. Okay, and this heat current will give rise to a thermal gradient, right? So that is the Peltier coefficient. And then this kappa is the thermal conductivity. And this is telling us how well does the system transport heat. Why is that? Because it is telling us the proportionality constant of the heat current to the gradient in temperature. Okay, when the electric field is zero, right? So when the electrical current is zero, then if you apply a thermal gradient, how much would be the heat current, right? So this proportionality constant is the thermal conductivity. Okay, so these are basically the transport coefficients that arise in electrical and thermal transport. Okay, so this roughly concludes the transport part. Okay, but I want to end this with something very interesting that this particular author has highlighted. Okay, so let me tell you what that is. Are there any questions at this point? No? Good. Okay. So there are a set of relations called Onsager relations. And these Onsager relations or Onsager reciprocity relations, these are relations between L11, L12, L22 and so on. Okay. And there are many other coefficients also, depending on how many perturbations you apply. So the a very general form for these transport relations can be written like this. Okay. The electric field is basically rho times J. Then we have already written an S times gradient of T. Don't worry about the plus minus signs. Okay. Then you can also, if you had an electric field, right? So you could have, for example, a nu times J cross B. And also a gradient of temperature cross with the magnetic field. Okay. So if you had a magnetic field also along with an electric field, then you can have two new effects. Okay, the cross product of the gradient in temperature of the magnet with the magnetic field can also produce an electric field, right? And if you only had an electric current, then the cross of that with the magnetic field can also produce an electric field. Okay, now these two we have already seen. This is basically the Ohm's law, and this is telling us that the thermal gradient is producing an electric field. Okay, now in this relation, can somebody tell me where is the Hall effect? So my claim is that in this equation, the Hall effect is actually hidden. Where is it?
It's a new part, third part.
Why is that? You are right. The new part actually describes the Hall effect.
Sir, because J represents a current, and we are giving a current in a direction and an electric field, and it is a cross product, then the it should be perpendicular to this to be to so that it will exist. And the electric field in the left hand side is deciding the new field produced perpendicular to the current.
Correct. So suppose I take the current in the x direction, right? And the J is basically Jx times I hat, and the B is in the perpendicular direction, right? So let's say I have, there is a current flowing in the x direction, and this is say Y, for example, and this is Z, right? And I apply a magnetic field in the Z direction, okay? So this is telling us that this is going to be this times B in the K hat, right? So this will give us a minus Jx B J hat, okay? So this is going to give us an electric field in the Y direction, okay? And that's basically the Hall voltage, right? So this term in fact encodes the Hall effect, and what this particular author argues is that if you include the heat transport equation as well, there are many, many more effects that are probably still waiting to be discovered, okay? So let me tell you the other equation also. Sorry, let me just write this. This is zeta. Okay, and the other equation is for the heat current, that is given by the Peltier coefficient times the electrical current minus the thermal conductivity times the gradient in temperature, plus another coefficient theta times J cross B minus by the way, these are all tensors. This is also a tensor. Okay, so if you include these, you can see that there are so many phenomena that are probably not even discovered. So some of the examples this author has given are as follows, okay? So one is Hall effect that we have already discussed. Ohm's law and the Fourier's law we have already discussed, right? And the thermoelectric effect also we have discussed. Basically, JQ being equal to K grad T is the Fourier's law, right? And the JQ being equal to pi times J is the Peltier effect, okay? So this is giving you the Peltier effect. This is giving you the Fourier law. This is the thermoelectric effect, okay? And this is the Ohm's law. And you can see that each of these can now give you new terms, right? And we have already discussed the Hall effect, okay? So in the Hall effect, if there is no thermal gradient, the del T by del X is zero and del T by del Y is also zero. And the current in the Y direction is also zero, which means it's an open circuit condition. Then you can see that if the J was equal to Jx times X hat, and the B was equal to B naught times Z hat, then it will give us an electric field in the Y direction, okay? So that's basically the Hall effect, right? Now there are other effects which I had not actually heard of. There is something called an Ettinghausen effect, okay? And this is telling us, this is the following: del T by del X is equal to JY equal to JQY equal to zero. So what is this saying? That the electrical current in the Y direction is zero, which means you have an open circuit condition in the Y direction. Don't apply any thermal gradient in the X direction, okay? And the heat current in the Y direction is also zero. So you maintain equal temperatures on both sides of the Y direction. In this case, what could happen is that if you apply an electrical current in the X direction and a magnetic field in the Z direction, a perpendicular direction, okay? This can give rise to a thermal gradient, okay? So what we saw here is that a current in the X direction and a magnetic field in the Z direction can give rise to an electric field, the Hall voltage, in the Y direction, right? What this is telling us, the Ettinghausen effect, is basically the same conditions here, but that can give rise to a thermal gradient, which is del T by del Y, okay? So, and there is also something called an Ettinghausen coefficient. Like the Hall coefficient, you can also find out something called an Ettinghausen coefficient, okay? And all of this is happening because there are tensors here, okay? Remember, these are all tensors, right? And because they are tensors, they relate different directions to different directions. Something happening in the X direction can affect something happening in the Y direction, Okay, so that is the importance of the tensorial nature of these response functions, right? Then there is something called a Nernst effect, which many of you might have heard of. So in the Nernst effect, you say Jx equal to Jy equal to the thermal gradient in the y direction is zero. Okay, you apply a thermal gradient in the x direction alone. And when you do that and also apply a magnetic field, so now here, instead of applying a current in the x direction, you are applying a thermal gradient in the x direction, and you apply a magnetic field in the z direction. Okay, this can give rise to an orthogonal temperature gradient. This gives rise to an electric field. Okay, so this is exactly the opposite, because what we are doing is we are applying a thermal gradient and a magnetic field and getting an electric field. Here we applied a current and a magnetic field and got a thermal gradient. Okay, so it's in some sense the Ettinghausen and the Nernst effect are inverses of each other or reciprocals of each other. And then there is something called a Righi-Leduc effect. Again, I had not heard of this. It's basically Jx equal to Jy equal to Ey equal to zero. So the current in the electrical current in the xy directions are zero, and the electric field in the y direction is also zero. So basically you short it in the y direction and you apply a thermal gradient in the x direction and a field in the z direction. Okay, and this gives rise to a del t by del y, a thermal gradient. Okay, so here you are applying a thermal gradient in the x direction and a magnetic field, which gives rise to a thermal gradient in the y direction. So this is equivalent to the electrical Hall effect. This, you can call this as a thermal Hall effect, because in the electrical Hall effect, we applied an electric current in the x direction and a magnetic field in the z direction that gave rise to a electric field in the y direction, in the orthogonal direction, right? Here we are applying a thermal gradient and a magnetic field and getting out a thermal gradient in the orthogonal direction. Okay, so in some sense, this can be called a thermal Hall effect. Okay, so you can see that how all these different perturbations are getting coupled here, right? So what are the different perturbations that we are applying? We are applying an electric field, we are applying a gradient in temperature and a magnetic field, right? And given these three, there are many different directions as well in which you can apply. And given all these three different directions and these three different perturbations, you can get so many new effects. Okay, so this is where I want to end the transport part. We will take up optical transport separately, but you can see that already in the DC transport in the steady state, there are so many new things that are happening, right? And in one single set of equations, you can capture so many different effects, right? And remember, all these different response functions at the Boltzmann transport level can be calculated using the IN tensor. The IN tensor that we had written down, if you know how to calculate that, you can calculate all of these response functions in a unified way. Okay, so any questions?
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
Sir, in the electrical current due to the electric field, that means ohmic situation. Sir, can you just say briefly that in case of semiconductor, where are the contributions of holes coming from? Because it is solely by electrons. Absence of electrons means holes, but how to know differently from this equation? Can we just get from this equation?
Yeah, actually you can. So I did not talk about that. So in fact, when we wrote down the expression for the S, okay, remember when we wrote down the expression for the S, it was actually proportional to minus E, okay? But the conductivity tensor was actually proportional to E squared, okay? So if you apply purely an electric field and calculate the conductivity tensor experimentally, let's say, then you cannot distinguish the sign of the carrier, okay? However, there are two experiments which actually can give you the sign of the carrier. One is this thermopower experiment, okay? In the thermopower experiment, you're applying a thermal gradient and calculating the electrical current, okay? that actually turns out to be proportional to the sine of the carrier. In fact, one can show that the density of states has to be asymmetric between the holes and the electrons. Okay, which means you, if you had a completely symmetric conduction band and a valence band, right? And these density of states are exactly symmetric about the chemical potential, then the thermopower is actually zero. You will not get any thermoelectric effect. Okay, the density of states or the mass of the electrons and the mass of the holes should not be the same if you want to extract any thermoelectric effect. Okay, in fact, it's been shown in one of the notes that it is actually proportional to log of Me by Mh. Right. And the other thing is that the thermopower is actually proportional to the charge of the carrier itself, not the charge squared, which means that by looking at the direction of the current, you should be able to figure out whether it's the hole that are transporting the current or whether it's the electrons. Okay. So the charge of the carriers is reflected in the thermopower. And the other thing, other experiment which tells you is also the Hall effect. Okay, so that is very well known, right? That the Hall coefficient is actually proportional to 1 over Ne, and that also gives you the sign of the charge carrier. Does that address your question?
Yes, sir, I understood quietly. Okay. Sir, can I ask another question not related to this topic so much?
Okay. If anybody else has a question, then let's address that. And
yes,
then
you sir. Can ask. After yeah? that, I will try.
Sure.
Sir, what is the relation between this P, rho, pi, k? Is there anything?
Or the can you repeat that? P, rho, I, k? Which is that?
Is there any relation between the coefficients?
Not rho, direct relation. No. See, there is no direct relation. But if you remember, what I said is that rho is basically proportional to I0, okay? The I0 tensor, right? And if you write the S, that is proportional to the I1 tensor. This is proportional to the I1 tensor, and the kappa is proportional to the I2 tensor, okay? Now, what happens is you can actually figure out all these different coefficients in a relaxation time approximation where you take the tau to be constant. It turns out that there is a certain relation between the thermal conductivity and the electrical conductivity, and that goes by the name of the Wiedemann-Franz law. Okay, so if you want, I can cover the Wiedemann-Franz law in the next lecture. And the Wiedemann-Franz law is basically a universal law which is valid only for something called a Fermi liquid. Okay, and a Fermi liquid is like a conventional metal, except that it will have a different, the electrons will have a different effective mass, and the interactions will be renormalized and so on, but it will behave almost like a free electron gas. Okay, so there the Wiedemann-Franz law is actually valid, and it's used as a diagnostic, in the sense that if a certain system violates the Wiedemann-Franz law, then you can say for sure that in that system, the electron-electron interactions are extremely important and cannot be ignored. Okay, so there are certain universal relations between these coefficients in certain limits, but not in general. Okay.
Okay.
In fact, the Wiedemann-Franz law has been dealt with very nicely in the Ibach and Luth book. So if you go through their thermal transport part, you should be able to see the Wiedemann-Franz law discussion there. But I can do that next time. That involves basically the calculation of these integrals. That's all.
Okay. Is there any method to calculate the Eigen integral?
Calculate the I integrals?
Yeah.
There are actually, see, what you are basically doing is that you are calculating the VV del F0 by del E and then E minus mu to the power N. So suppose I assume that the tau is independent of the K. Okay. So the tau is independent. So what you can do is, first of all, transform all of these to density of states integrals. Okay. So from K, you can go over to the density of states by doing DE times d of e, and then integral v times delta of E minus Ek. Okay. And then what will happen is that this whole thing becomes a density of states integral. Okay. Instead of it being a three-dimensional integral over K, it becomes a one-dimensional integral over the energy. Okay. Except that there is a hidden three-dimensional integral, which is called the transport density of states. Okay. So if you can calculate this transport density of states separately, then you can go ahead and calculate this I1 or I2 or I3 IN integrals. However, it's very difficult to calculate this analytically. Except at zero Kelvin, you can calculate the even integrals. The odd integrals will all vanish. But at any finite temperature, you get very, very complicated expressions in terms of gamma functions, di gamma functions, and so on, even when you apply a lot of approximations. So let's say if you take the density of states to be a square root E or a constant in two dimensions or a 1 over square root E in one dimension, even then you have to apply a lot of approximations like the Sommerfeld expansion and so on. And then you can get these expressions in terms of some special functions called the gamma function and the di gamma function.
Okay.
But mostly it's done numerically. I mean, because see, what you want to do is, let's say you want to calculate for a specific material. Okay. And for that material, let's say you have done the density functional theory calculation and you've got a band structure. Then from that band structure, you know what the V is as a function of K, right? So you can just substitute that and then calculate these integrals over the first Brillouin zone, right? So that turns out to be most convenient.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Yeah, Shovik, you can ask. I mean, it's already 5:30, so people can log out if they want. But any case, yeah. Go ahead, Shovik.
Sir, in all the cases, we have neglected the transient case. That means we have treated steady state. Sir, I just want to ask by curiosity that is there any system that that is very effective or very strange phenomena in the transient state? That means, can we just make a material whose time for suppose the time to go to the steady state is very large, and we can have a new phenomena, just like in Mott insulator we change the electron density, so and we go from metal to insulator.
Yeah, absolutely. So in fact, there is a very hot topic right now these days called many body localization. Okay. And in many body localization, the basic question that people are trying to ask is as follows. Suppose I take an isolated quantum system, okay, and I don't attach any reservoir to it, right? And I push this isolated quantum system out of equilibrium. So the question is, will this isolated quantum system come back to equilibrium on its own or not? Okay. See, normally when we talk about transition to equilibrium for any system, we say that there is, let's say you have kept a cup of hot tea on the table. Okay. Now that cup of hot tea is not in equilibrium because it's losing heat to the environment, right? And it's exchanging heat with the environment, right? So, and the temperature is rapidly changing. Okay. But there will come a point where the temperature of that tea will be exactly the same as that of the ambient. So the room is acting like an environment, okay? But if I had kept that hot tea in an isolated environment where the tea could not exchange, the cup could not exchange any heat with the environment, okay? Either radiatively or by convection or by conduction, then that system will be in equilibrium, right? Will it be in equilibrium? If I isolate it, what do you think? Hello?
Sir, I don't know.
Can you guess? So I heat the system, okay, and then completely isolate it. What would happen?
Sir, if there is complete isolation, then how the exchange happen?
It will not happen, right? It will not happen, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. But now let me do the following. I take an isolated quantum system, right? In that isolated quantum system, the electrons are strongly interacting with each other. Okay. When I say interacting with each other, it means that there are inelastic collisions happening between electrons. Okay. And now what I do is I turn on a current in the system by applying an electric field. I have some contacts. Okay. So I keep it open for a short while, right? So I turn on a current and then at some point I remove the contacts and isolate the system. So the current that was flowing has to die down. Okay. But the question is, if it is completely isolated, will that current flow forever or will it actually equilibrate and the current will actually die down? Okay. Or this was one example, but you can have other examples where you create a non-equilibrium distribution of electrons, which is not the same as the Fermi-Dirac distribution. And then you ask the question whether that non-equilibrium distribution will equilibrate, right, to the Fermi-Dirac distribution at some point of time. Yeah.
Sir, if there is a collision between the electrons, then the current will die down. The current means there is some flow.
Whatever that non-equilibrium distribution is, that will equilibrate to the Fermi-Dirac distribution. That's what we will intuitively think, right?
Yes.
Yeah. But this is where the many-body localization has entered. And what people have found is that for many-body systems, remember, if we had disorder in a system, I told you about a phenomenon called Anderson localization, where electrons get completely localized in real space, okay, because of disorder, right? In many-body localization, what happens is that the electrons can get trapped in the Fock space. So what I mean by that is that whenever these electrons are interacting, we cannot describe the system by single electron states. Okay, we have to describe them by many body states, right? So each wave function has n degrees of freedom, where the n are the number of particles in the system. So these wave functions can be written as linear superposition of states in the Fock space, right? And these Fock spaces are actually direct sums of the Hilbert spaces. So what happens is that the entire system gets trapped in the Fock space in a certain region, okay? And that is called many-body localization. So what I'm trying to say is that these isolated interacting quantum systems, as they approach equilibrium, it turns out that in the transients, they get stuck in the Fock space and are not able to move out of that Fock space, okay? So in some sense, you can think of it like this. Let's say I take a harmonic oscillator and I isolate it, okay? Then you know that a harmonic oscillator in the phase space has an elliptic curve. You know that, right? The phase space curve for a harmonic oscillator is an ellipse.
Yes,
do you
sir.
Know that? Yeah. Yes. So the idea is that if I put the harmonic oscillator on any point of that ellipse, then it's going to remain on that ellipse forever if the energy is conserved, correct?
Yes. Yeah.
So in some sense, if there is an integral of motion involved in the system, which is the energy in this case, then the phase space motion of that system is restricted. Okay. So in the interacting quantum many body case, it turns out that there is an emergent integral of motion. Okay. And because of that, the system gets trapped in the Fock space. Okay. So this is something that is, heavily being investigated by a lot of groups worldwide. So this phenomenon is called many body localization. And there are many other effects also. Actually, transient superconductivity also exists. Transient spin glass phase also exists. So there are many effects which actually happen in the transient. Okay. But one topic that I thought was very exciting is this many body localization. But there are many others.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank
okay.
You.
Yeah. So we'll meet next Wednesday.
Sir, can you